So I'm going to talk a little bit about sort of how you see big data from the point of view of a for-profit concern. I think that's what I was supposed to do today. And I'll just use some brief examples of how we're kind of looking at it. This is a slide about who we are, CVS Caremark. I'm going to put that up because we do have a lot of data coming through. We've got about 70 million people in our pharmacy benefit management company, Caremark. And then we deliver about 1 billion prescriptions a year through the CVS retail pharmacies. And we have about 2 million people a day coming into the 7,500 pharmacies. And we're developing the retail clinic functionality. Our electronic medical record contractor tells us that we'll be the second largest to Kaiser in terms of number of ambulatory visits in 2 years. So that's a lot of data that comes through, and we do tend to capture data well. The pharmacies were wired up or electrified long before the rest of healthcare, and we can use that data in a fairly supple fashion. So we do have access to big data. And there's a lot of big data companies out there right now, that some of whom come in and sort of visit with us, and they've got a lot of interesting ideas about sort of how to manipulate the data with simulations and optimization and enumeration. Saw a presentation from a big data company recently about analysis that was done on a PBM, now defunct PBM, merged with another one of the PBMs, on drug interactions, and they demonstrated how they went through over 45 quadrillion hypotheses, and they eventually identified a relationship between Plavix and Omeprazole, which got a lot of press. The idea was that if you were on both Plavix and Omeprazole, you were at higher risk for having a poor cardiac outcome than you would be if you were not on the Plavix. But the question is that interaction really for real? And I come at this from the point of view of having been a medical student at Yale and working with Alvin Feinstein. I was never a fellow under Alvin Feinstein, but Feinstein was the original sort of clinical epidemiologist and terrorized a whole generation of people who were trying to do clinical epidemiology in healthcare centers at the national meetings. But his big concern was that you shouldn't examine data without a very strong hypothesis, and that the data should be put together in order to examine the hypothesis. And that's not what big data does. Big data is like big slicing and dicing, and people think just because you've got a bunch of data, you should be able to run it through these machines with a series of simulations, and knowledge is going to come out. And Alvin was very worried about that, and maybe appropriately so, because when you look at the Plavix story, Plavix Omeprazole story, what was done was finally a more or less randomized controlled trial that was published in the New England Journal in 2010 by Bott and colleagues. And what this shows is basically the sort of Kaplan-Meier plots about what's going on, both with regard to developing GI symptoms. If people were on Omeprazole, they didn't develop as many GI symptoms. And yet there was really no difference that they could demonstrate between cardiovascular events and cardiovascular outcomes for people who were on placebo as opposed to people who were on Omeprazole. And the final analysis was there's no interaction really between Omeprazole and Plavix. Now, this is still a big data company out there today talking about the interaction, but the interaction has been relatively well disproved. You can see these p-values here. It's a specific study that was done for the specific purposes of examining the interaction. So that's why I start the talk by saying you got to have a certain amount of skepticism. Just because we've got literally billions of data points coming through daily from our enterprise, it doesn't mean that there's anything smart for us there. So I think that you have to take big data with a grain of salt. And obviously, some of the things that George was saying resonate with that. And this notion of sort of correlation and causation, which is, of course, key to long-term clinical epidemiology, I think is going to become ever more important as people do examine the sort of strengths and weaknesses of what would be considered sort of relatively hypothesis-less interrogation of large data sets. Now, having said that, we have been using what might be considered sort of big data firms to do some analytics for us. When I first got to CVS, we were trying to decide what were the best stores to put our retail clinics in. And each of the retail pharmacies has about 1,000 different data points that they identify that range from the number of cars going by every day to the people who are shopping the store to the things that are sold within the store to the prescriptions that are being rendered there. And so we thought we could sort of take that data and analyze it with the existing retail clinics we have and identify what are the best stores to put retail clinics in. Really important issue for us because these retail clinics were losing a lot of money, and it seemed like it was random in terms of which were going to be busy and which weren't going to be busy. So My analyses ended up showing nothing. I couldn't find any substantial factors. Having given up on that, and somebody willing to do a sort of pilot for us for a relatively limited amount of money, we engaged a firm. And they did do some very much more interesting computational methods based in mathematics than what we were able to sort of pull out of the bag, being kind of epidemiologically oriented. And what they've come up with is, you know, a much better set of parameters. So now we've got all 7,800 of our stores basically rated from 0 to 7,800 in terms of which ones would be good for putting a retail clinic in. And what we found over the course of the last 3 years as we've expanded the number of retail clinics is that we're really hitting the mark. They're getting a great R squared. These show basically the sort of current minute clinics. That's what is what MCs are on the left-hand side. And then our more recently opened minute clinics. And what we're finding is higher and higher correlations. So they're getting R squares up in the 0.6, 0.65 area, which for us is great. So this has been a really important business outcome for us using what might be considered big data, because they're running literally, I'd say billions of data points through these analyses in order to come up with the algorithms that we use. So that's really successful. And now we're sort of orienting ourselves a little bit more towards health. This is a rendition of a graph that was appeared in a paper that we published in Health Affairs about a year ago. And what we were trying to do is demonstrate that certain interventions that we were doing were improving patient adherence. I'll only use it to sort of make the point about adherence. These bars are basically percentages. On the y-axis is percentage of people who are taking their medication. And then the bars go out for 18 months. Each bar is a month. And what you can see is the blue people are people who at 6 months we intervened on and put a program in place to try to improve their adherence. And we demonstrated that it was successful. And then we turned it off. The intervention is not that important. The important thing here is, first of all, people don't take their medications. This is well documented that over a period of 8 to 10 months, people on chronic medications stop taking them. And that's a big issue for us. It's a big issue for us in terms of being a healthcare company, because if they can get adherent, their costs will be lower, their care will be better, they'll suffer fewer poor outcomes. And also from a business point of view, if they're adherent, they take their medications, and obviously that's our business interest. So addressing adherence is really important. The other thing that's important is that this shows, if you turn off interventions, then people stop being adherent. And so that means we've got to be very careful about sort of trying to find out who are the people who are going to be adherent and who are the people who are not going to be adherent, because we want to spend all of our time on those people who are not going to be adherent. The last point that this shows is that this is just a summary. And so what we're doing with big data now is trying to take this entire group and have them not just sort of showing on one graph, but what's happening to different subgroups within this, because we think there's different patterns. And you can use big data to fit people to sort of different sets of behaviors, and as a result, different curves in terms of what they're doing with regard to adherence. So we have a pharmacy care research institute that we have about 70 or 80 people in, and we work very closely with research teams at the University of Pennsylvania and at Harvard University, at the Harvard Medical School. And our Harvard Medical School colleagues have put this together. They've identified certain phenotypes of people. So certain characteristics of people cause you to fall into a certain phenotype, and those phenotypes have different patterns. You can see, if you look at number 5 down there, that's a group of people who very quickly sort of fall off, whereas group number 1 is a group of people who are staying adherent all the time. So what we're doing with these data sets is basically trying to figure out what are the predictive analytics associated with who's in each phenotype, and then we'll concentrate our activities on 4 and 5. Now, the interesting thing about this is if you take these phenotypes and then look at their outcomes, what it shows is that the people who are not adherent, so like the large sort of burnt orange group is group 5, those are the people who are not adherent. You can see they suffer many more poor outcomes in terms of heart failure, acute cardiovascular events. And so this demonstrates that this phenotype really does work in terms of identifying people, not only who are not adherent, but then who are going to have poor outcomes as a result of that. So that's something that we're really excited about. The other thing we're doing is trying to layer on a variety of different sort of analytic techniques. So take logistic regression, then put census variables in, put in clinician-selected predictors about what's going to happen, use boosted regression, and then take all of that and take the information from the first 3 months of what happened to that individual and repeat that process. And what we're finding as we sort of layer these things on is that we're getting to really high R squareds, especially when we take sort of what's happened in the first 3 months somebody's on a medication. So these R squareds in the 0.83 to 0.85 area are really sort of off the charts, unprecedented high. So this is something that makes us think we're getting closer and closer to be able to sort of predict with reasonable data that's available just through the PBM data that we have, who is going to be taking their medications. That'll be revolutionary for us. It does suggest how big data can help in healthcare, because these people, if we can get them to be adherent, will have fewer poor outcomes, will reduce the amount of suffering these individuals have, will reduce costs overall for the healthcare system. So that's exciting. Now, the other thing that we're doing, and this goes to sort of extension of big data, these are basically sort of regular logistic and boosted logistic regressions that we've done. Again, we're looking at an R squared here. What's our ability to predict whether somebody's going to have a PDC at the bottom is a prescription, is basically demonstrating whether or not they've had their medication. So it's a medication possession ratio of greater than 80%. How are we able to predict them? Well, you can see if we use regular regression, then we boost it, which is a sort of big data technique, we can get a much higher R squared. Now on the right hand side, we're taking not only the claims data, but we're also taking some data from front of store. It's all washed, this is all double blinded. So we can't tell who these individuals are in these kinds of analyses. But what you can see is that some of that data from the front store boosts what we are able to do in terms of prediction. So I think that's a second plank of big data, taking data sets that are normally disparate, bringing them together, and trying to understand whether or not they can help in terms of increasing the accuracy of what you're doing. So I would say from our point of view, we're excited about the ability to do sort of better analytics. The term big data itself is fairly meaningless to us. We think you have to be very careful in terms of just going out and trying to sort of run regression after regression after regression and try to find some needle in the haystack. We don't think that's a good way to go. Slicing and dicing is not it. But if you're careful and you're more or less driven by carefully developed hypotheses, and then you build analytic on analytic on analytic, we think that there's going to be some real promise out there. And from a point of view of a company like ours, we see ourselves as a healthcare company, improvements overall in healthcare, but also from a big company like ours, improvements in the way in which our business operates. So I'll leave it there. Thank you.